Okay. Maybe I will start with a disclaimer. So it's my first time on stage since last year, January last year. So I can imagine I'm going to be a bit rusty, and I'm really sorry for that. But that's not my fault. That's organizers. They invited me here. They should check that before doing so. So if something goes wrong, then just please be nice to me. There should be a mandatory slide about me, but instead of that, I have about StarCraft. StarCraft's awesome. There are global finals now in California, WCS. And if you like this game, just I highly recommend watch it. It's online on twitch.tv this evening and tomorrow evening and day after, I think till 6th of November. StarCraft is mostly, these finals are mostly about this guy, so Serral, this is the best, I would say, Zerg player in the world, definitely in Europe. And as you can see, he won 4 of 4, so all the important tournaments outside of Korea. So those finals are about him and this guy here, so that's Maru, top player from Korea. All StarCraft fans are just like dying to see those two players playing against each other, hopefully in finals. Sadly, I think it will be before finals, so one will have to lose, but that's super exciting. And if you are not excited or big fans of Maru and Serral, then this is all the players taking part in finals. Definitely you can find someone that you will root for. I would just suggest this guy over there, that's Nercho, Polish Zerg player. I don't see him winning or like even going to like semi-finals, but still a Polish player, that's something really, that's something that excites me. So yeah, that was about me. Now let's move on to topic of this presentation, live data. I wanted to cover three topics: live data, coroutines, and a navigation component. Sadly, there is no time for that because I spent some time speaking about StarCraft. Also, Piotr covered navigation components. So we just focus on live data and try to answer the question, how it's even possible that live data can won't be killed during configuration change. That has to be a magic, right? And the second topic going to be coroutines, how it's even possible to write a blocking code in a way without callbacks or without RxJava. So let's start with live data and try to answer the question how this magic works. So the problem here that Google wanted to fix is that there is this idea of configuration change on Android. Like back in the day, it was either physical keyboard being like on this G1 or M1 device long time ago. So there was a physical keyboard you can just like extend it, so to speak. So that triggered a configuration change event. Of course, nowadays it's mostly turning a device from portrait to landscape mode. There are other configuration actually events that will trigger this restart of activities or fragments, but that's the huge problem on Android. So Google in 2018 decided after like 10 years of Android to fix that, actually after 9 years, because they provided this library last year, right? So they decided after 9 years to help us developers, they come up with a really nice a tool. So previously we were like struggling with unsafe instance and callbacks to DAG. To save something in unsafe instance callback, we need to provide a parser label or something that can be just put into bundle. So that was always a problem. So many of us were not just persisting state across configuration changes. Now it's all fixed thanks to live data, but how it works. Just to explain how live data works, we need to focus on all the components actually that are part of this whole library. So architecture components, I believe that's the correct name for that. So there are a couple of components that Google provides us with. So that's lifecycle. And lifecycle is basically, this is something that activity or a fragment has, right? So this, I will show that in a second. But yeah, there is a lifecycle, which is abstract class, by the way. Inside of this class, we have a couple of things. I will show that in a sec. Another thing that we need to look at to see how live data actually works is, not sure if you notice, I'm saying all the time live data. We'll come up to that later, but that's actually not live data that is surviving configuration changes. But yeah, I will try to have a surprise for you folks. So we'll say live data, but that's not live data. Okay, so we have lifecycle, we have lifecycle observer. So that's a concrete implementation of that abstract class of lifecycle. And then we have live data, which is another abstract class, and there is something. And I won't name this something now, but by the way, naming is hard, and later we'll see how this something is called, and we'll have hopefully lots of fun because of that. Okay, so we have those new components, and all of them, if you use all of them, then out of sudden live data can survive configuration changes, but how it works. So let's start with lifecycle. So what is lifecycle on Android? That's an easy question, and the answer for that is also easy. So basically, for me, for many years, that was lifecycle. So it basically was Googling, typing in Android lifecycle, having all those images, because no one is looking for anything else than that, than images, because what I was looking for was those two images, right? So that's Android lifecycle. And there is a really nice one image that's like having both activity lifecycle and fragment lifecycle glued each to another. But basically, this is lifecycle Android. So what's important in here, and I have this, I have a pointer. So what's important in here is that in this lifecycle, we have two things that are interesting. We have events, so on. So what's that? On create, on start, on resume, and then we have a state that activity is running, right? Same here. We have some events, and at the end, fragment is running, and here maybe fragment is created or just initialized. Okay, so in lifecycle, in real lifecycle on Android, we have states and events, and what lifecycle in this architectural components by Google is basically is a Java code that just guys from Google, they implemented, or maybe I should say, codified this diagram into concrete code. How it looks? Kind of easy, to be honest. This is not rocket science. It's something that, which is actually maybe one of the things that you can take from this presentation, that the whole nice architectural components library is basically a couple of easy to understand classes that each of us could actually implement. So lifecycle, the way that Google implemented that is just basically an abstract class that has two methods that we are not really interested right now. But those in this class, we have two enums. One enum to describe all the events happening in the lifecycle, and one enum, so that's enum event, and another enum, so state. So basically, state is just a state of an activity or a fragment. So lifecycle basically is just that, and nothing more. All those events are basically listed here. And if you just maybe remember that diagram, basically all the on create, on stop methods, those are just events that we can have in this lifecycle. There is one on any idea where it's used, but then we have on any event as well. So yeah, that's event in a lifecycle, the way that Google implemented that. So what is state? State, this is state. So basically something that has lifecycle. So let's say fragment can be destroyed, can be initialized, then be created, most probably after an onCreate call, can be started, can be resumed. We know that fragment can be also paused and stopped. And what's really interesting, there is no state for being paused or stopped. We'll talk about that in a second, but yeah, there is no on stop state, but there is on stop event. Just an interesting thing to point out. Another thing which is interesting about state, this method in here in the enum. So this is something that actually LiveData is using. So you can query someone that has lifecycle, so fragment, to ask that something in what state that lifecycle owner is. So we can make sure that a fragment or activity or two more things actually have a certain state. So that's actually interesting, and LiveData is using that. Anyway, what is lifecycle owner? So how many lifecycle owners do we have on Android? Four. That's activity, obviously. That's fragment, obviously. That's service, that's not that surprising, but also application, which is called in the library a process. If you think about application, actually application has a lifecycle, because it's not created at first, then it's created, then it's most probably started. So we user is looking at an activity that is displayed to the user. So activity, application is started, and then maybe it's paused when it's in the background, and maybe it's destroyed when it's basically being killed by the system. So there are four lifecycle owners. We can create our own, but those four are provided by architectural components. And one important thing is that this is activity. This is something that we use all the time. What I wanted to say here is that you may say that I'm not interested in live data. I'm not interested in live cycle or owners or whatever. I'm not using this API, but we are still using that because it's baked into fragments and activities. So you may not use that, but it's there for you to use. You cannot not to have it, so to speak. Okay, how it's implemented, how this lifecycle owner, so let's say activity, how it's how it looks inside. So basically, just like one line of code, at this one right here, there is lifecycle owner. And also there is lifecycle registry, which is an implementation of lifecycle. So basically to activities and fragments and services and application, there were those two classes being added. So lifecycle registry and lifecycle owner. And that's that. So two more fields. And basically we can also get lifecycle out of those owners. So basically really tiny change to like those important classes, so fragments and activities. And that's that. And this is how you became a lifecycle owner. Just add those two things to your something, a class, or in this case, activity fragment, service, or application. Really easy, to be honest. So how it actually works in action. So this is a fragment lifecycle here on the right. It's small, but we all just like have that already in mind, right? So so basically what's happening when a fragment is being started by a fragment manager is, what I'm looking at now is fragment. Actually, I'm looking at lifecycle registry. So inside of a registry, we have the state, and the state at first in the constructor is set to initialized. Then it's moved, state is moved to created, and how it happens, because there's an event on create, right? That's actually not surprising, right? So then obviously what's going to happen somewhere here is that fragment will be started because there will be event on start. So that's on start callback, right? The next step is resume post, which is kind of obvious. And actually it's not, because there is no state post. So that's something that's surprising and confusing at first for the first like 5-10 minutes, because the state is started. So even though the callback here is called on pause, and event is called event on pause, the state goes back to started. So states are basically just those like four in here, and there is no on pause. Basically, if you are not resumed, then you are started. So that's that. The next state obviously is on created, when we stop fragment, which is kind of confusing at first, but then this is how it works. And at the end, if we destroy fragment, so like somewhere in on destroy, then event on destroy is being emitted and the state moves to destroyed. So that's kind of easy. The only confusing part is that you are not paused, state is not paused, but started. But events are just like they should be, so to speak. Okay, so this is how inside of lifecycle registry, state is being changed because of events, but how it's implemented. So actually kind of straightforward. So we have a fragment. Inside of a fragment, fragment manager is calling, so doing some transaction stuff, so that's fragment manager. And at some point in time, when fragment manager decides to change state of a fragment, we'll call method called perform resume, or perform stop, or perform start, or perform create, and so on. And inside of, this is part of a fragment manager. Inside of a fragment manager, we just check the state, if it was started. If new state is after started, so that's resumed, a method is being called on a fragment, right? So what I did is basically I just tapped on that and to check how it's implemented in the fragment. So that was fragment manager. But what's happening in the fragment, which is lifecycle owner, what happens there is basically this. So inside of a fragment, on resume is being called by a fragment manager. And then how it happens is that fragment manager calls perform resume in a fragment, and that perform resume calls our own resume. Okay, so that's our own resume that we have in our fragments, that if when we implement fragment. And that's that. Basically, just we are being called on resume, and as you can see, there is no change of state or even being emitted, because it's on the next slide. Because in the very same perform, what was that? Perform resume, what's happened, like line below is this part. So fragment is perform resume. This is different state to get us confused. This is not related to lifecycle state, but it's also resumed. Our on resume is being called of our fragment, and then somewhere here, here, registry handle lifecycle on resume. So fragment manager is basically doing its own stuff, and then Google added this one line right here just to move forward the lifecycle via lifecycle registry. So as you can imagine, this code, so this one line, actually there are two lines, but let's just forget this view at this moment, just focus on the state of a fragment. So this one line was added to each and every perform resume, stop, start, create, and destroy, and so on. So this is an example of perform stop. This is code from the fragment manager. At some point in time, fragment manager, when it's moving state to something before start, so to stop, we call perform stop on a fragment. Perform stop on a fragment, which is like not our fragment, but like this base class that we extend from when implementing our fragment. So perform stop will be called. Some stuff will happen. Some different state will be changed. Don't get confused. And then our on stop will be called. And what's interesting in here, there is no next slide, because actually event is emitted before our on stop is being called, to get us a bit more confused. So going back to previous slide, do I have that? Sorry. So just going back here, when resuming, first on resume is called, and then event is being emitted. But when stopping, first on stop, first event is being emitted, and then our on stop is being called, which actually makes sense, because when we are resuming our fragment, at the moment of when our on resume in our fragment is being called, most probably we are still in the started state, right? We are about to be resumed. When being stopped, actually, we are being stopped. So first we are being stopped. So now we are in the created state, and then our on stop method is being called. Okay. So there are actually two things that are super confusing. First of all, there is no state stop, it's state created, and then the order of method, how they are being called. But then, anyways, the whole implementation is just one line, and that's that. This one line was added in each and every place in a fragment when needed, also in activities, also in services, and also in application, which is actually kind of interesting. Let's focus now how lifecycle is implemented in application. This is something that I did myself in a actually similar fashion. Just imagine you have application that's being started. So application on create is being called, right? And most probably, let's assume that someone is tapping on an icon. So the next step is going to be an activity started for our application. So it's not a broadcast, not a service, just someone is starting our app. So on application on create, next step activity is going to be created and shown to the user. So how it works? So basically, kind of easy. There is a callback for that. And some of us maybe already use that. I use this myself. So you can register yourself to get all the on activity start, on activity post callbacks. The list of the callbacks is kind of long. They have like a helper callback in here, which is not doing anything for the rest of the callbacks. But the list of the callbacks is like, I think, 10 callbacks. So activity started, paused, resumed. And what Google did, basically, as you can see, they are just keeping track of all the activities that are being started. And this is how they implemented the lifecycle of application. And it was like this. Application is created when it started, then it's resumed when an activity is being shown, then it's paused when activity is not being shown. And the question is, when the application is being killed? Because if you have a lifecycle of activity, when we change we rotate the screen, then activities are being killed. In a sec, they are being resumed, right? With the new configuration. So how to know that application wasn't killed, but it's just all the activities are now gone because we are rotating screen. So how it's done? So basically, there is inside of activity post and all the callbacks, there is a delay of timeout of 700 milliseconds. So if activity will be paused and won't go back in 700 milliseconds, then it means your application is done. And it's most probably like in the background or it's being killed. So the magic value is 700 milliseconds. Honestly speaking, for me, when I was doing that, it was more like a second on the other devices. So I wouldn't trust actually in that, but maybe the rest of the code is doing the magic. I'm not sure if 700 milliseconds is enough for that, to be honest. Anyway, this is how it works. We have this delay. We just make sure that we are in the correct state. And how do we do that? We just add some extra ifs and whatnot. So basically, after 700 milliseconds, we can double check if there is an activity being shown to the user. And then we know the application is actually on the screen. So it's created or not, then it's stopped. So that's the whole magic. And the API was for us there always to use, right? It's basically just going back to the slide, application register activity lifecycle callbacks. Okay, public API, and Google basically just wrote all the stuff in here. The only interesting thing is this report fragment. So there is a fragment which is not having any UI, and the fragment is there just to be attached so that they can get all the events also to the fragment, because fragment manager is doing things with this fragment, and that's how they are knowing what the current state of the fragment manager and fragments in fragment manager also is. Okay, so that's a lifecycle of application. Some proper programming, but really not that fancy. The only fancy thing is 700 milliseconds, I guess. The rest, something that we did, I'm sure, ourselves as well. Okay, so on to the question, how live data can survive rotation changes? And of course, it cannot. But how? So what live data is? Basically, live data is a piece of data that can emit values to interested parties. That data is basically just an object, and we can do that emission in two ways. We can change the data in the live data on the main thread, on the backend thread. We have two methods for that. And the best part is live data is not emitting changes to data that it holds for folks or fragments activities that are not started. So that's live data. It's basically just an abstract class. And the way we use live data is like this. There is something, this, that just takes live data and observes that. This owner is a life cycle owner, so something that has life cycle. And then we can observe that. So this is how we glue all the things together. We have live data that lives in something that observes on owner, which is life cycle aware. That's why live data can ask owner, are you in the correct state? And if you are on the correct state, let's do something, okay? So how live data survives? The answer is, it doesn't, because there is a view model. So those are my three stars that I showed on the one of the previous slides. So live data is not surviving configuration changes because there's a view model for that. Live data is just like a integer with some extra stuff. Okay, so how a view model works. And first of all, maybe there is a slide for that. So I will just, hopefully there is a slide for that. So how a view model works. So first of all, view model is kind of silly. It's just nothing. I'm not sure even why it's abstract class. It's just something that has a method. I guess you could just create a default method, so that could be interface. But yeah, view model is nothing that requires us. Actually, not requires us. We can implement onCleared method. So that's a view model. So that's nothing. And how it's all glued together? How view model survives configuration changes? More or less like this. Or first, let's start how to create a view model, and then we see how it's all good with the lifecycle. So I'm in a fragment or activity. I have an onCreate method, and now I try to get a hold of a view model. There's a view model providers that takes activity, but actually it's not activity. It takes a lifecycle. No, it takes activity. Sorry, it takes activity. So view model providers takes activity or a fragment, and then says, okay, give me a view model of certain tab. What happens under the hood, there's some boilerplate code, but what's actually there is that view model provider takes a view model store out of activity. So now we know is that there is a view model store that lives in activity, and this is through this view model store we get a view models. So how it's implemented inside, view model get, and if not there, then just create the instance and put it there. So it sounds like a view model store is just something like a map. I just get this view model from an activity, see if my view model is there. If not, I just create a view model, put it to the view model store, and just return also view model. So that's a kind of simple code, right? There are some levels of abstraction, but in the end, the way we are getting a view model is basically like this. To get a view model, just take a view model store from activity or fragment, and then just ask it to create by name, or by name. Just give me a view model of and there is a string value of that view model. And if it's not there, instance is going to be created. If it's in there in this map, we're going to get that. So view models are from activities and precisely from a view model store which lives in a activity. So what is view model store? And that's all. Basically, I think only this comment will just make it a bit shorter. View model is a hash map. I can put something in there, I can get something from there, and I can clear the hash map. So a view model store, it's a hash map, and it's not that hard to implement a hash map, right, and put it into activity. Actually, only Google could do that, to add something to activity, or maybe we could just create our own version of activity, like base activity or base fragment, and having a map inside. So yeah, at this point, we know that live data most probably lives in a view model lives in activity, and most precise in a hash map, which is inside of a view model store. So the question is, how it even, what is that? Okay, yeah, I just said that, sorry for that. So basically, this is the whole thing. So this is how it's done. Also, something that I would like to point out is that naming is hard. So view model at this point, 2018, end of 2018, we have view model like this one I just show you, so one from architectural components, so that's one view model, basically abstract class on clear method. We have another view model which is in the documentation for data binding, and this view model should supposedly extend base observable. We have another view model if you use MVVM, that's going to be our view model with use cases and whatnot. And there some of us have a third view model which is basically a base class for presenters. That's super confusing, but this one right here is not actually Google's fault, right? This is something that some of us are doing to ourselves, that our presenters are extending view models, which is, yeah. Anyways, naming is hard, so I'm talking about this one here, view model, which is actually nothing. My suggestion would be just call it a differently, not a view model. I think I have a really good name for that, but then the question still stands, how it survives configuration changes. And now, this is how it is being done. So I'm in a fragment activity, so in activity basically. In a create method, there is this line of code. There's an API. I was told that some of us were using that long time ago. I never heard about this one, and I'm 37 years old. But there is API called get last non configuration instance. And the idea here is that we can, as an activity or a fragment, we just, when a system is doing things to us or change, killing us because of configuration change, we can say to Android platform, please take this and give me it back when you are going to resume me, right? So how it's done? So it's done like in the fragment activity, in our client method, this is when they are restoring view fragment, so sorry, view model store. So basically they are calling this method to get a class, and inside of this class, most probably there will be a store. So all the view models are being put into a store, which is a hash map. Then this hash map is being taken out of this get last non-configuration instance. How it's being stored there? Very simply, so there is a callback. So when Android is doing, is trying to kill our activity or fragment, we have this method that we can override, and inside of this method, we can just return whatever we want. And what happens here is that non-configuration instance is being created and view model store is being passed there. So activity is going to be killed, but all the view models that are in the view model store is going to be passed as a configuration instance and restored in non-create. And that's that. And the best part is that in non-destroy, actually, you can clear all the view models. So sometimes you want to just get rid of them. So there is a chance to do that in non-destroy. This is how it's been done. That in non-destroy, we are just making sure, are we being destroyed because we are being destroyed, or are we being destroyed because of the configuration change? Because if it's configuration, then we are fine. If we are being destroyed because user is just navigating out of our activity, like bug or being killed, activity is being killed, then just better clear all the view models because they won't be needed. And that's that. And the best part is that this API is available to all of us since Fragment support library version 22. I think that we are at the version 1.0 now because either the counter rotated after 9.9 or there is new Android X. So I'm not sure which one is true, but definitely 22 is kind of old. So it's available to us since some time now. And a shocker for me was that actually similar method was available since API 1. So that's Android A, and I'm not sure even there's a name for Android A, to be honest. So this API, there's a different name, but we could use this API since forever, and this could be implemented also since Android 1, so at least for 10 years now. But in 2018, we got this from Google, which is still cool, right? So there is Nomadi, there is super old API call, and now Google is just having a huge map of all our view models and all those live data, so whatever we want, we keep in those view models. The view models goes to store, which is a hash map, and this hash map is being just retained through all these API calls, which are there for forever. And actually, that's that. So I could actually show only this slide. So live data is not being persisted by itself. It has to be stored in a view model, which goes to the model store. And all the life cycle, which was scary image to all of us, at least for me, now it's just basically a set of two enums, events and states. And naming is hard. This is my suggestion. Instead of calling that a view model, just call that one that survives configuration changes, because this is what this view model actually is. Nothing is there. It can be just stored in the view model store and in that way survive configuration changes. So that's that. And basically, you can use it. You can don't like it, but it's always there. Always there. So it's baked into activities, into fragments. So I must say that it's not external. It is external library, but also most of the stuff is already there in activities and it's like kept in memory and using our memory, so it's waste not to use it. Okay, coroutines, second topic. Hopefully we have time for that. Super interesting one, and hopefully you are using coroutines. I'm not. Actually, thanks to all of you, I was able to research this topic. I love async tasks now. I love RxJava, and most probably I spent lots of I love it because I spent a lot of time on that, and now I just I'm kind of sad that all this knowledge is gonna be like replaced and actually not that needed anymore because of coroutines. But then, thanks to you guys, I forced myself to research topic, and coroutines are super cool. It's basically magic if you look at the IDE, but if you look at the implementation itself, it's not that. It's not magic anymore. It's great, but it looks kind of silly in a way. Let me show you how it works. So what are coroutines? So basically, this is something like kind of definition. So basic coroutines are a way of suspending a function. So if you have a function, I'll show it in a sec. So basically, every time we call a function, we're going to go from the top of the function, from the first line of the function, right? And in coroutine, you can just suspend execution and go back to the very same line that we ended up like in the previous step. So that's a some sort of a definition for coroutine, like for a student of a medicine or not necessarily someone from IT with IT background. And another thing that very often is being said about coroutines is coroutines are lightweight threads. So I will try to show what really means to be lightweight thread and what really means to be a suspended function and how it actually works. Okay, so and another thing that people say very often about coroutines, that coroutines are just to fight the so-called callback hell. And honestly speaking, it looks like JavaScript to me, even though I think I wrote that in the Kotlin file. But honestly speaking, this kind of code it's not Android. It's not Android that I'm using like nowadays or like for last 2 years. So I'm not sure if it's a good example to say that coroutines are to fight callback hell, because most probably they are to fight this. So this is like modern Android or like modernish Android, huge stream, lots of RxJava stuff, some operators, retries and whatnot. And the idea is that instead of doing this in a form of a stream and having all the backgrounding thanks to RxJava and all those operators, so retrying and whatnot, we can write this just like in a blocking fashion. And then maybe a try catch around that, so or for to do a retry. So I would say this is like a better reason for coroutines to exist. So how coroutines looks like? So basically, this is almost a coroutine, and this is a code that we would write in a coding blocking fashion, right? As you can imagine, this method is supposed to make a network call, so definitely a blocking operation. We are not allowed to do this on UI thread. Another blocking operation here, another fetch image. This compose is doing some stuff in the background. And here we are going to display something onto UI. This example for coroutine to exist is very often being used because two blocking operations, another one basically composing images can block us, and then we're going to do on the IO thread, right? So on the background thread. This one we have to have on the UI thread, right? To show thing on the UI. So it's almost a coroutine. Actually, the way coroutines are being done, so all those methods are like in the blocking fashion. To switch them over to coroutine is basically as easy as this. Not sure if you see the difference, so I'll just go back and forwards. So basically, we add suspend keyword. And this is actually great because in a C#, you need to add async at the front, and the return value is going to be a task of something. And the way it's implemented in Kotlin is great because we don't change the signature of the method, actually the body as well. The only thing we have to do is just add a suspend. So we need to do some work, but not that much. And the signature is without task or defer. It can be, but it's not. And it looks a bit better. Still something needs to be done, but it's not that hard. So that's how we do coroutines. And the question is, so how it's even possible that this thing now will be done on the executed on the backend thread and one block application. So how it works is basically it's not everything. We need to wrap off of our so-called suspended functions, because now they are being called suspended functions thanks to this keyword. We have to wrap that with something called a coroutine builder. And that coroutine builder will have a scope. And this is basically a Kotlin 1.3 and the new version of coroutines. But the old version look kind of similar. Anyways, so code that was blocking And then we unblocked it a bit with suspend. We wrap all of that with a launch, and now we have proper coroutine that has a bunch of suspended functions. So how it works inside? Let's see. Basically, this is a proof actually that the threading is being done correctly. Actually I did it for myself to make sure that I know how a coroutine works. Like I said, I never used them before. Yeah, this is a proof that it works. So the question is, what if I tell you that coroutines under the hood do the same stuff as callbacks? Is it even possible that we write blocking code and out of sudden it's being unwrapped or wrapped into a callback? It's not like that, but almost. So how to make sure that, how to understand how coroutine works? There are a couple of options. First of all, you can use Google and Google for presentations. There are at least two presentations. I think one is from KotlinConf, another one is from DroidCon New York. In both, people show how more or less it works. The other way is basically create a sample application, then compile it. At the end, we're going to end up with a DEX file, which is bytecode, and then we can decompile that bytecode, and everything will be there, right? You cannot hide it from us. I mean, at the end, it has to be a Java bytecode, and then we can decompile that. And coroutines are just basically, at the end, basic Java stuff, or has to be, just like like our Java code is being compiled to a bytecode, same stuff with coroutines which are in the Kotlin. In the end, it's bytecode. So this is actually, I did the other part, so I decided to decompile stuff just to spend some more time on that. But yeah, Googling is also a good thing to do, to be honest. Anyways, I created a sample file just not to have main activity, all the rest. In this sample file, I have my, this now I'm back to old version of coroutines. Just a small syntax change. Anyway, couple of functions. As you can see, I keep two functions, fetch image two, which is a blocking version of this one, which is suspended version, just to show you the difference in the compiled code, okay? And then what I did is basically I created an application, then use APK tool to decompile this application. And first of all, I wanted to use Android Studio, because in Android Studio you have a class file. You can go tap on this class file, see that there is no code in here, but there is a tools called in decompile to Java. Sadly, it doesn't work with coroutines. It just takes lots of time, and you end up with like 48 megs of Java code, and Android Studio says that it cannot open the rest. No idea why, but it doesn't work with coroutines. So the next step was just tapping on the DEX. Basically, it doesn't work with me in this way. So what I did actually, I used DEX to Smiley. You can use APK tool. Basically, DEX is somewhere there in when you build application, DEX file is somewhere there in the build folder. And there is a tool to convert DEX to everything. Smiley is a, I love Smiley because of APK tool and stuff I did with that previously. Basically, Smiley is like a assembly code. It's register-based, it's like programming language, it's not as convenient as writing in Java, obviously, or Kotlin, but you can read that as a programming, as just like a code, and then I will show you how it works. So basically what I did was, I created an application, created a DEX file, then decompiled that to Smiley, and I'm going to show you the Smiley to show how actually coroutines are being implemented under the hood. First, blocking method, how it looks in Smiley, like this. So this is Kotlin, this is Smiley. Basically, like I said, it's register-based, but we can read that, right? So we have a function, which is private static final. This function takes string as a parameter, returns string as a parameter. Parameter P0 is always URL, because that was hard-coded in the sample application. Some stuff is being done. Here I have invoke static. This is a method from the Java virtual machine. I just call a thread and sleep. This is my example, right? I was sleeping for 5 seconds. Some simple function, blocking function in the Smiley. How it looks when we go with suspended function. So it looks like this. It's a bit more scary, but what's interesting is here that our fetch image function that was having only one argument, which is string, not has two. The second argument is a continuation, and it was returning string, now it's returning object. So what's happening under the hood when we put a suspend keyword to our function, Kotlin compiler is adding another parameter, so continuation, changing return value of our method. Why it's doing so? Because it's trying to change our method to be suspended one, so the execution can be suspended and eventually resumed in the next step. So this is a slight change to our function. In Kotlin looks nice. In the Smiley we see that there is a change to our function. What's the next step? And the next step is going to be, so basically this is what's happening. We write this code, this ends up in the Dex file, okay? More or less, this is not a valid method, but more or less this is what Kotlin C is doing with our method. Next step. This is how we create a coroutine. So a couple of suspending functions we wrap with a builder and maybe in a function. So what will be done with this by Kotlin C compiler? More or less, a scary thing will happen, but let's try to understand it. So first of all, our function will be converted, see, here, into a class that will extend something called coroutine implementation. So a function is converted into a class. This class will implement something, and this is a proof that basically we are in the right file, so I'm not wrong about that. So the coroutine builder will end up as a class that extends coroutine implementation. Next step. Next step, what is coroutine implementation? Basically, it's abstract class. You can go and check it. It's part of the coroutine library. Coroutine has a couple of interesting things. A context, which I will not focus on, has a continuation, which is kind of interesting. Won't focus on it as well because it's kind of confusing for me as well. Maybe I'll just point it out in a sec. But what's interesting about coroutine is that it has a resume method and resume with exception. And this is the whole magic of coroutine, that we can just we can suspend coroutine to do some stuff on the background and then resume from the, let's say, next line of the source code, right? And this is how it's being done. The whole thing that will suspend here, and here will be resumed by coroutine at this point, and at this point. And basically continuation in this line, by the way, this is a symbol how Android Studio is showing where are suspension points. So this line, for this line, this is a continuation, right? For the next line, this is a continuation. So continuation is the remaining part of the function or lambda that has to be executed after we get data out of this suspended function. So suspended function and continuation. Suspended function, continuation, suspended function, continuation, everything is a coroutine. And everything, like I said, this function ends up as a class that extends this class. I'm kind of hurry because only 5 minutes left. We have two methods, resume, and the interesting part is that doResume is being called. So how doResume actually looks? Most probably, this will end up in the doResume. So two options to do that. We cannot do this in this way because that's going to block. So callbacks or what? So definitely not callbacks because we're fighting with callbacks hell. So what else than callbacks? Switch. Let me show you that. So that's Smally for doResume method in the code that was generated for my coroutine. Oopsie. So how it looks? This is Smally. It looks scary at first, but it is the first line of the doResume method. What you can see here, we have packed switch. So this is a huge switch. This is how Smally represents a switch. So there is a huge switch. This huge switch will switch over a label that's being taken from the continuation. So this continuation that was added to each and every suspended function has a label. So we do some code, we pass continuation, the label is being updated from 0 to 1 to 2 to 3 and so on. And basically this doResume is going to be called. Inside of doResume, we're going to do this packed switch and then going to find the proper label to jump to, go to. So we have label 0, label 1, and there are go-tos, as you can see. There is a one go-to, there's two go-to, second go-to, and so on. So basically what Kotlin C is doing for coroutines is more or less, this is another down part, lower part of the file, but you can see here in this particular line, or right here, a fetch image is being called. And here, so that's label L6. In label L7, right here, another fetch image is being called with the second image, and somewhere below a compose will be called. So my code, which was written in a blocking fashion, Kotlin C, is converting into a class that has doResume and huge switch inside. So this, like I said, is being converted to this. And this is like a way for me to represent how coroutine is being implemented. This is not proper Kotlin code. And just to show you that, there was a class that was created that extends coroutine implementation, which is private, internal, so I cannot actually extend that. There is some extra stuff in here, but what's interesting, there is a doResume method that takes data of any type. Inside of that, this one is interesting. Maybe in a second I'll explain that. But anyways, I just take from coroutine the label, and then I try to execute the remaining part. And the way it's being executed, I just go, okay, so I'm at the first step of the coroutine. So what was the first step? Let's say fetch image. And depending if the method is suspending or not, if the value be available for me on the spot or not, so I can just either suspend, just say to runtime that I'm suspended waiting for result, or I can just update or bump a label to next value and resume again. And then I will go to another label, so resume again, and so forth, so on. So basically, blocking code is not converted to callbacks, but to a huge switch. And basically that's that. So bunch of suspended functions wrapped in something which is called coroutine builder ends up in the bytecode in Java bytecode as a huge switch. It's even bigger if you try to decompile that using Kotlin to Java decompiler in Android Studio, because like I said, it's generating 50 megs of Java code and something's buggy there. But yeah, this is a huge switch. And last thing, you have two more seconds. The best part, lightweight threads. So very often people show in the presentation about coroutines that they can create 100,000 coroutines. And if you try to do that with threads, you have out of memory exception. And the best part is, and this is the why coroutines are awesome, and of course, coroutines are lightweight threads. So how do threading in JVM? Just by threads. So the way coroutines are lightweight threads, there is no magic there. Basically, you don't create 100,000 threads, you just create a executor that has like pool of threads, like 64 for instance, and then you just execute your code using that pool, and that's how it should be done, not by creating 100,000 threads. And basically this is how light threads work in coroutines. There is a dispatcher, which is basically a pool of threads, and all of our coroutines, depending of which dispatcher we use, the shipped ones, so IO or main or our own, will be executed over those threads. And it's even in documentation. And basically, coroutine dispatcher is just wrapping an executor that just executes lambda, so parts of coroutine, using those threads. There are cool things like you can switch threads and whatnot, but in the end, there is no magic there because it cannot be there. There cannot be any magic because we are on the JVM, so we have threads, and mostly that's that. So coroutines, they are lightweight threads because someone just created a pool of threads. I believe it depends on how many CPUs you have on your device. It's, I think, up to 64. So yeah, I can imagine you can create 64 threads in your own application like easily, right? So it's not like only works with coroutine. So this is, I believe, my last slide, and I should have one more about Q&A, but I don't have this slide because maybe we don't have time for QA. Do we have? If there's any question, so I'm done. If there's any question, I'm more than happy to take it here or offline. So there's one question there.
Yeah. How about live data that is bigger than 50 kilobytes or 1 megabyte? Because that's the limit of the bundle.
So the question was if live data can have more than 50K of data. So so live data, if you put that into a view model, I'm not sure what this get instance call is doing with that. I'm not sure if it's like trying to parcel that and put that into a bundle. So I would say just try it. I never tried this myself. But then also I would say just put that data into database and just have an ID in live data. Yeah, but then it's going to be kept in memory. Live data is kept in memory if the API is, you are referring to ViewModel, right? And ViewModel, so this, I'm not sure how what's under the hood this platform provided get inst. Retain instance, blah, blah, blah method. But it's not definitely on safe instance store when you put things into bundle. Any more questions? OK, thank you very much.